Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the service of worship at Grace United Church this morning with a bit of a different beginning today as you enjoyed some music and some scenery and hopefully helped you to get into the space ready to worship. Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. Our God is a great big God. Let us gather ourselves, for the call is written in the bulletin. God cries out, whom shall I send?
Dare we answer.
God calls out, who will go for us?
Dare we respond.
Christ says, drop your nets on the other side.
Dare we listen.
Christ tells us that we will now catch people.
Dare we follow.
Dare we? If we do, then let us live the call, truly and completely. Let us come to this place in praise and thanksgiving, being refreshed and renewed by God's love.
We dare. We are here to worship and to
respond. Our opening hymn this morning is number 635, All the Way My Savior Leads Me.
Thank you.
confession.
We are your people. We are your witness to the presence of your love and creation.
Yet instead of being bold in our witness, we fear how the world will respond to our faith.
Too often we are hesitant in sharing the gifts with which you bless us, fearing what others will think.
God, we pray that you open our hearts, free us from fear and doubt, so once more we will show the world what it truly means to have faith in your love. Amen. And let us say together our words of assurance. Our God moves with power and grace in our lives, forgiving us and freeing us always.
I invite you now to take a moment to greet your neighbor and to pass the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How is everyone today? Good. So even the songs we were singing this morning talks about God's call to us. And last week we heard a call story about Jesus talking to Philip to ask him to be a disciple. And then Philip was so excited about helping Jesus that he told his friend Nathaniel, and Nathaniel realized that Jesus really was the Son of God, and he decided to follow Jesus too. So we talked last week about some of the things that God or Jesus would like to see in our hearts if we are a disciple. And we came up with these words. We had love, we had happiness, we had kindness, we have to listen, respect, and responsibility. So I'm going to tell you the story of a couple more call stories of people who were called to become disciples for Jesus, and let's see if we can come up with a few more words. Today's call story, Jesus called fishermen. And see, there's a picture here of people fishing, what a fishing boat might have looked like in Jesus' time. So they catch fish, that's right. And so what do you think fishermen know about being disciples? Do you think they were trained or educated? No. Yes. Yes, that's what they knew how to do. They knew how to fish and to catch big fish, and that was their business. But they didn't necessarily know anything about teaching or working with Jesus, because all they had ever done was fish their whole lives. So so what do you think that they would need to do to be a disciple, to follow Jesus? They would need to follow, but there's lots of things that they would probably have to learn, right? Yes? All right. We're going to put down the word learn. And what story do you think Jesus wanted them to tell people? I know not all of you were here last week, but yes. What does Jesus want us to know? Jesus wants them to teach people about love, right? We have love here. So love of whom? God wants to teach that God loves them, and that all people should love each other. So then he went down, he walked down the beach, and he saw some more fishermen, and they were John and James, and they were fishing with their dad Zebedee, and he asked them to follow as well. So here Jesus had four disciples who were totally untrained, didn't know about teaching or anything like that, and they were going to follow Jesus and help Jesus teach people about being disciples. So I think one of the other words I'm going to add is teach. So were they going to be teaching fish, do you think? No, who were they going to be teaching? Other people, right? So do you think that they would just stay at the beach and do that? They would walk all over the country with Jesus, teaching and learning about God's love for everyone, and that we should learn to love everybody as well. Okay, thank you very much for that. And we now need to have a volunteer for the prize panel. Okay. Let's explain. We light the Christ candle this morning in witness to the fact that Christ, who is our light, is here among us. And now you can walk this.
In prison, Jesus went to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew cast a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little further, he saw James, a son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Let us sing together hymn number 356, Seek Ye First the Kingdom. He sits in the cab of his truck for an hour, wishing he had done something to save Mary Alice. Finally, he makes a vow to God. Eli Stubbs, handyman, decides from that moment on that his life would be repairing not only things, but lives. What a great call story. When a man who has spent his life using his skills and talents discovers that he can continue to do what he has been created to do, only now he can do it in partnership with God. In contrast, our Bible stories today might be titled, might seem like missions impossible. God sending Jonah to Nineveh was like God asking us to go to the Middle East and mediate a peace in Syria. Or sending us to Wall Street and telling us to sit down and work out a better economic situation. Jesus choosing fishermen to be his first four disciples was like God asking you and I to go and heal all the people with cancer. Or sending us to go solve world hunger or bring about world peace. These calls, not to mention the one that Jesus had to die so that the world might be born again, seem much more like missions impossible than God's people doing God's work. Did you notice that none of our characters last Sunday or today actually chose their calls? Not Jonah, whose story ends with him angry at God and sitting under a tree pouting. Nor Peter, Andrew, James, and John, whose stories ended in exile, seclusion, and martyrdom. These people did not decide to go do God's work. God just met them exactly where they were, with what they had, and walked along with them until they found themselves doing it. God pursued them until they found themselves. What do you think it is that we fear so much about God's call to discipleship? Is it that God will ask us to do what we know, or think that we know that we are incapable of doing? But then, why do we talk about giftedness and our own God-given uniqueness and the fact that nothing is impossible with God? Author Parker Palmer speaks of our calling, not as a goal to be achieved, but as a gift to be received. Not from a voice out there calling me to be something that I am not, but from a voice in here calling me to be the person that I was born to be. Perhaps the difficulty might lie in the difference between who we are and what we do. Our faith and our trust in God may tell us to go and tell, but we may seem ill-prepared or perhaps worried about failing. But then, how can we fail if we are simply telling our own God story? It seems that we can't. But first and foremost, we have to learn to listen. Listen to what God is saying to us in the midst of difficult situations and hard times. Listen to what God is saying to us as we fret about our jobs or our homes or the economy or the political scene. Has any situation changed who we are or how God cares for us? We have to learn to trust that God is with us, with all of us, through it all. And let's not wait until we think that our life is good for God to use us in our lives. Being a disciple is not about being ready, but it is largely about our point of view. God wanted to use all that Jonah had been created to be, But Jonah ran away out of fear and contempt for the people who God loved. So God used him differently and had him testify to the sailors on the boat until they too became afraid and threw him overboard into the sea. Then God sent that saving whale so that Jonah could be returned to the place where he started out. Before God reopened the dialogue the second time, Jonah was sitting on the beach, covered in fish saliva. Do you think, in that situation, that he felt like saying then, "Now I'm ready to serve God"? And that's where we enter the story of Jonah today. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. "Get up and go to Nineveh, that great city." And this time, Jonah obeys. He walks into the city, one day's journey, and preaches the shortest sermon ever recorded. In Hebrew, it's a sermon of 5 words. 40 days more and Nineveh will be overthrown. The response is electric. Immediately the people of Nineveh believe God. The people declare a fast. And the king, not to be outdone, orders human and animal alike to fast and to put on sackcloth. Then all those sackcloth-covered cows and sheep and people talk out their repentance to God. And God changes his mind about the punishment and does not bring it about. We might think that Jonah would be ecstatic. After all, he's the only really successful prophet in the whole Bible. He has brought about a mass conversion that one could only aspire to. Every inhabitant of the city, human and animal alike, has come forward to repent. But Jonah is not happy. The NRSV version plays down his anger with the words, "This was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry." The Hebrew reads roughly, "It was evil to Jonah, a great evil, and his anger burned." He tells God why he ran. "For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing." Jonah is angry at God because he, Jonah, didn't want the Ninevites to be saved. He didn't think that the people who he regarded as his enemies deserved a second chance. God speaks to Jonah, trying to explain, but the book of Jonah ends without resolution, and Jonah goes away mad. Jonah doesn't really totally realize the person that he was created to be. The preacher Kathleen Wakefield says, "Jonah spends 3 days inside the whale, in the darkness, so he will have time to think, so he will learn a lesson." We too spend much time in darkness. The vengeance that we sometimes desire, the hurt feelings and the grudges and the rages that we might carry for years weigh us down and eat at us. We ourselves are the ones who suffer the most in these situations. It does not hurt the other person. The Ninevites were not hurt by Jonah's reluctance. Only Jonah was. But it damages us spiritually, relationally, emotionally, and physically. We are the ones spending time in darkness. We are the one who is in prison. There is a story about an incident that occurred some years ago during a flight from Johannesburg, South Africa, to London, England. A woman with a European accent got on the plane. She came down the aisle to the tourist section and discovered that her seat assignment put her right next to a man with, shall we say, an African accent. She looked at her seat assignment. She saw that it was correct. She asked her seatmate, "I'm sorry, are you in the right seat?" He smiled and nodded yes. She turned around to see if there were any other seats in the section, but she didn't see any, so she tugged on the sleeve of the flight attendant. "Excuse me," she said. "As you can see, I'm sitting next to a person whose skin color is different from mine." "Yes, ma'am, I can see that." "Well," she said, "this is simply unacceptable. Is there another available seat?" The flight attendant looked at her strangely and said, "I'm sorry, ma'am. It's against our policy to move people unnecessarily." "You don't understand," said the wealthy woman. "This arrangement will not do. I have funds in my purse to arrange an alternative." The flight attendant said, "You do?" "Yes, I do. Would you please go to first class and see if there is an available seat?" The flight attendant shrugged her shoulders and walked up the aisle. A few minutes later, she returned. She leaned over the European woman, tapped the man with the African accent, and said, "I'm sorry, sir. I hate to do this. I must make a seating change. If you would follow me, we have a place for you in first class." In response to this story, William Carter says, "The love of God makes it possible to give every person first-class treatment. Every person, no matter who they are, no matter their color, their race, their gender orientation, whether they're rich, whether they're poor, disabled or strong. Every person, no matter how we feel or think. The love of God makes it possible to give every person first-class treatment. May we all, in our own time, experience the privilege to give every person first-class treatment. All to the glory of God. Amen." I invite you now to respond to God's grace. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We give through the church so that listening and prayer for the isolated and vulnerable might be offered through our ministers and lay people. We give through the church so that Christian education for children, teens, and adults might expand one's sense of value, purpose, leadership, and service. We give through the church so that ideas of grace, unity, wholeness, and respect might grow legs and become real through the coordination of Grace United in Tavistock and the United Church of Canada's reach globally. We give now because we were created to give ourselves away in service to God. Our offering will now be received.
Thank you.
written in the bulletin. Lord, take what we offer this morning as a sign of our readiness.
Bless us in our eagerness to answer your call into the world. Bless us in our perseverance as we serve. Bless us in our faithfulness as we seek your face in us. Bless us as we love. Amen.
Lord Jesus, we are in church today because you have called us, invited us, summoned us here. We are here not because we searched for you, but rather because you searched for us and found us, claimed us, and gave us jobs to do in your kingdom. Sometimes we are amazed by your faith in us. There are times, too, when we do not think that we have the gifts or the abilities to do what you expect of us. Yet you have called us. Help us to have as much faith in ourselves as you have in us. Give us what we need to do your work. Attune us to the needs of brothers and sisters who clamor for justice, mercy, and peace. Broaden our compassion for neighbors near and far, whose burdens, pains, and afflictions we are called to share. Strengthen the connections that bring together all who follow you. This we ask for the sake of your kingdom. We offer prayer today especially for Bev in Nicaragua. Bless her and the ministry in which her group is involved. We pray for those who are sick at home and for those awaiting surgery. We pray for those who are lonely, for those who are grieving, and for these persons for whom we are concerned. Lord, may they feel your presence with them and within them. And now we pray together using the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I would like to draw a few announcements to your attention this morning. First of all, thank Tara and Elizabeth for contributing to this service and helping us to worship as Bev has led us so many times. This afternoon, there will be a movie afternoon in Knox Parlor starting at 1:30. The movie is called God's Not Dead. And immediately following the service, those of you who would like to stay and learn a little bit more about Remit 6, will be a short presentation on that. As well as out of remits comes change. So one of the remits that was voted on last year, where presbyteries are coming together, actually ceasing to exist, there's been a change in boundaries. So I will show a map to show that situation where we are. The boundaries changing so that Most Alive Conference remains the same, except that here on First Presbytery is going to be on the north side of the border, so we're going to be separated and from a region from Oxford. And but other than that, I don't think it's going to make a change in how we our church here in Tavistock. I would invite you all as well to stay for coffee and conversation. Refreshments have been prepared, and we can enjoy those in Zion Hall. Ask Shirley for a minute for mission. This one is entitled, Thank You from Green Bay. You all know that I usually read one about different. Our gifts for mission and service support congregations in transition or in remote locations. Green Bay South Pastoral Charge is a grateful pastoral charge in the midst of beautiful Notre Dame Bay in Newfoundland and Labrador. This scenic three-point pastoral charge has been receiving financial support from Mission and Service for a number of years. The small charge is spread over 40 kilometers with one church accessible only by water. Over the years, a Mission and Service funded mission support grant has enabled the pastoral charge to adjust to declining numbers and build up its ministry. It anticipates being self-supporting in the near future. The generosity of the United Church has sparked the members' own compassion and kindness. They are generous givers and support mission and service. They see firsthand the benefit of being a recipient and feel compelled to give the wonderful ministries that we support together as a to grow, I'm sorry, the wonderful ministries we support together as a denomination. During each Sunday service, a blessing can is distributed among attenders. People can express their gratitude, name a blessing, and offer a donation. These dollars are set aside as additional donations to specific mission and service partners through the Gifts with Vision program. Board Chair Lloyd Colburn says the members enjoy this time of thanksgiving and appreciate being able to grow their ministry and mission. He adds, we want to thank all of the congregation of the United Church for supporting us when we have needed it. We appreciate this opportunity we have to share our gifts in gratitude. Our gifts for mission and service accompany churches such as Green Bay. If mission and service giving is already a regular part of your life, thank you so much. If you have not given, please join me in making mission and service giving a regular part of your life of faith. Loving our neighbor is at the heart of our mission and service. Our closing hymn today is number 235, O Worship the King.
Thank you.
God chooses messengers and prophets in every age. God's work needs your prayer, your love, yourself.
Amen.